Good morning. So today is the last lecture on convection heat transfer, and we will start today with looking at condensation. Then we'll look at some practical issues, and I will end the session by showing some of the correlation sheets that I am passing out and just briefly explaining how to what they are and how to use them. Okay, so we begin with the condensation heat transfer, and remember, like what we looked at yesterday, boiling was the case where we had a saturated liquid becoming a dry saturated vapor. Condensation is exactly the opposite. So what one does here is that you have vapor which is moving or stationary, and we produce a surface whose temperature, or TS or T wall as we call it, this is less than the saturation temperature. It could be possible that in some cases we are trying to condense a superheated vapor, a slightly superheated vapor. That means there will be some sensible heat transfer in the vapor until it becomes a saturated vapor, and then it will condense. The fact then is that whatever the surface may be, so I'll just draw this air surface, and on this outside, say we have vapor, and we have maintained this surface below the saturation temperature. The thing is that as soon as this forms maybe a drop or maybe a film or whatever, this liquid that has formed here, a portion of that liquid will be at T wall, which is in contact with the wall. The one that is outside will be at saturation temperature. And so inside this liquid, there will be a range of temperatures between TW and Tsat, all of which are less than the saturation temperature. What this means is that this liquid which got condensed has varying degrees of subcooling. Now, this is inevitable in condensation, and this will come in as we look at the analysis of this. In all cases of condensation, except in some forced convection cases, gravity is an important player. It influences everything that happens in a fairly major way, and so we have to factor this thing in. So before we come to the analysis and see how we can get correlations that we can use for solving problems, let's just do the same thing we did yesterday and look at what are the types of condensation that we see. We'll start with the external forced convection and external natural convection. And here we have a classic example that we will look at, is that you have a vertical plate or an inclined plate or a circular tube which is kept cold, all of which are sitting in a large chamber of vapor, and we say that it is natural convection if the vapor velocity, say u infinity, this is very very small. If this velocity were large, we would be in this region. In some applications we will see this is the case. In some cases, very few cases, this is what actually will be happening. In practical world, yes, you have to have a flow. So we will have a finite u infinity. It is not exactly zero. And the thing that, okay, so that is one example there. We then look at any applications of internal flow and external flow around the tube. A very common example of that is a condenser of a power plant, and also condensers of very large central air conditioning plants. Condensers are also used in the chemical and process industry, where you vaporize something and then again condense it to make a product like say hydrocarbons. So that would also constitute this type of a condenser. Condensation with forced convection inside a tube, this means that There is a tube, maybe a circular tube. Inside this, we are pumping in saturated vapor. And as this goes in, we are cooling the tube from outside. So gradually, it forms the condensate, which is the liquid that is formed there. And this we continue until our objective is achieved, that where if we want to convert all of that saturated vapor to saturated liquid, which is what we want to do in the refrigeration system or in the power plant condenser, that's what we would do, that make a length and get that thing done. So in these things, the question that the engineer has to ask is that I have a certain mass flow rate of vapor, I want to condense it to make it a liquid. What should be the area I require and what should be the temperature of the surface? Those are the questions that the engineer has to do, and based on that, the complete structure gets designed. So here you could be how many tubes are there, where are you going to put it, how big should be a plate that we are looking for, here what should be the diameter of the tube and what is the length of the tube. So those are the type of questions that will come out of this. One more example of internal flow but with natural convection is what we call a heat pipe. We looked at this application yesterday in the context of boiling. Now we are going to look at it and say that, well, here is condensation also happening here. This side we have kept some fluid and this thing is in liquid state. Here there is a vapor. This part is exposed to an object or a space which we want to cool. So this takes heat from there. This vapor, this liquid becomes a vapor, and on the other side here, we cool it. So by a temperature gradient, this vapor which has reached the top, this will condense and this will begin to come down the tube and get back into the pool. So we end up seeing vapor going there and liquid coming down from there. So condensation happening on this side, boiling happening on this side. That's the heat pipe. I mentioned this yesterday that it is used for many applications in cooling, like including chip cooling. Now, one of the features about this, like boiling, was that when condensation happens, as you have substance going from liquid, from vapor to liquid phase, there is a huge decrease in specific volume, the thousandfold decrease, that time. So, what we are seeing in an application like this also, that every time a certain amount of vapor condenses, it creates a sort of a place of partial low pressure area, and that drives it off quite a bit. So this is one of the mechanisms also that comes in when we look at the analysis of this. So these are the different types of convection that we encounter and some of the applications where we see them. There are others that we have, and good to know about these. The one is called homogeneous condensation. And what one does here is that you have a saturated liquid or saturated vapor coming in here, and then we suddenly expand it into a large area. And as you have learnt in fluid mechanics and thermodynamics, what this will do is it will reduce the temperature, and because of that, this vapor will begin to start getting droplets happening over here. And then if we can either separate the droplets, we got our job done. Otherwise, this is what's going to happen. So this is homogeneous condensation. This also happens, although I've shown it as a stationary application where you have something coming here and opening up. We also see this happening in the stages of a steam turbine, where the steam is wet. So in a coal-fired power plant, the last stages of the turbine will have wet steam in it. And this is what is happening, as the steam which was superheated at the inlet slowly keeps expanding, it finally becomes a saturated vapor, and at some point as it starts passing through the stator passages and the rotor passages, it continues to expand, pressure continues to drop, and you start having droplets coming into it. So this is what was happening inside a steam turbine. In most nuclear turbines, you have almost entirely the whole turbine operating with wet steam. So you are always going to have a lot of droplets that are moving through the steam in the blade passages. And for a machine like that, which is rotating, what it means is that these are small droplets. They may be small, 100 micrometers, 200 micrometers, but they have a finite mass. they have a very high velocity, and if they come and hit the blade of a turbine, that could cause erosion. And that is something you have to, engineers have to worry a lot about, and they make all sorts of things to prevent erosion, and you have to replace blades if they do get broken or they get cracked. So that is another application of where this type of a condensation takes place. The good thing is that there is no surface heat transfer taking place in homogeneous condensation. That's the difference. Okay, the last thing that we will look that is there in use is called direct contact condensation. And here we have two possibilities, that we have a chamber into which we pump in a subcooled liquid. And this chamber is getting, say, maybe flow coming this way. This has got here, say, saturated or slightly superheated vapor. And what we are doing is, as this subcooled liquid comes out, we spray it and it comes out as drops. These drops come in contact with this vapor. Locally on the drop surface, this vapor begins to condense. The drop keeps getting bigger and bigger, falls down, and that's how this vapor gets condensed. So this is done in some power stations where you cannot afford a cooling tower to dissipate heat to the atmosphere. The condensate is taken out, cooled by the surrounding air or a water body, and that subcooled liquid is again sprayed back in. So that's what's called the direct contact condensate. The opposite of this is that you have a pool of liquid into which we introduce saturated vapor. So there are two possibilities I am showing here. We have the vapor being introduced from the top or vapor being introduced from the bottom. And this entire tank, this is containing the subcooled liquid. So what we have done is that this vapor is coming out. This is all vapor here. As it goes out as bubbles, they finally condense and the bubbles will disappear. So the vapor bubbles disappear and you have condensation taking place there. The same thing can happen here, that we introduce this, it comes out as big bubbles and finally they condense and disappear, and you have a liquid being formed there. So clearly, if this is a continuous process, then this liquid will also keep getting hot. So one has to keep putting in some of this liquid and taking out some of this liquid. So that becomes a continuous flow process. So these are examples of direct contact condensation where, like here, there is no surface at which there is any heat transfer taking place. They all have their own merits and applications, and so it is good to know that this is there. In what we are going to learn, we will not look at any of the correlations of this. We will go back and say, well, what is the simplest way in which I can begin to understand either this problem or this problem? Most of our applications that we are looking at will fall in one of these categories. If you are looking at a heat pipe, then you will have to worry about what happens inside a heat pipe. So we will look at these things, and the simplest configuration, like we did in natural convection and in also in forced convection, in condensation, look at it and say the simplest thing is a vertical flat plate which stands in a very large space of saturated vapor. The plate is maintained at a temperature lower than the saturation temperature. What will happen? So this is what we are going to ask now. So that's your basic configuration of a vertical flat plate. And in practical thing, when you look at a plate, that you create such a thing in a laboratory and put vapor on it, and say, well, what happens? A somewhat similar example of this is maybe in the bathroom when you have had a shower and you have used a lot of hot water, so there's a lot of vapor in it, and then you see the mirror or the window panes of the bathroom, they get what we call fogged up. That's exactly what is going on, condensation. And if you talk of fogging, it is also the case. If you are driving a car in monsoon or inside a bus and the windshield becomes very cold, then you have moisture developing on it. And what you see there is a very, almost like a uniform continuous film being formed, but actually it is lots and lots of very fine drops that came up, and that's what is getting fogging up. So it is a process of condensation, but different in the sense that you have air also playing a big part in it, but at the surface of the at that glass, this is what is happening. Now, if this were to happen more and more, then these fine droplets that were there, and this could be starting with a few microns or maybe even smaller than that, and then they gradually begin to grow up. And you have seen that what you do in the case of a car, if you heat up the surface, then the temperature rises and they evaporate and go back into the air. So you get a clear surface again. So this is a plate, and that was the idea of what we call fogging. But if there is more and more vapor coming in and more condensation taking place, these things will start getting joining up, more and more moisture will join up there, and this drop will start getting bigger and bigger. With time, they will get bigger. When you look at normal to the plate, they will look like circular drops. When you look at the side view in the cross section, they could have different shapes, could be like this, could be like this, depends on the wettability of the surface, which is basically the surface tension between this liquid and this surface. So sigma, the surface tension, becomes an important player over here. Gradually, as these drops build up, if you see them happening bigger and bigger, then they get something much bigger, this gets bigger, finally it becomes so big that gravity, which is acting there, it begins to pull it down. So it starts moving down the surface, detaches from the plate, and falls down as a drop. So lots of these drops will form there. And you have seen, maybe if it is raining and there's a very fine rain that is happening on the windshield of a vehicle, you'll find that very, very small drops are coming there. Gradually, more and more drops come and hit, and it becomes big. Two drops join up and become a bigger one. Then some other drop comes in, they join up to make a bigger one. Then finally, by gravity, they just go down. So that's what is also going to happen when this plate is maintained at is surrounded by a vapor, which is a saturated vapor, and this plate is maintained at Tw less than Tsat. This manner in which condensation takes place, and that is what you see most common in everyday life, this is called drop-wise condensation. And the nature of this phenomena tells us that, can I write exact equations for this? And so, well, yes, you can write equations for what's there in the drop, you can write an equation for the vapor, but can I solve these? What are the boundary conditions? So, well, it's very difficult to solve because there are drops forming everywhere. Which drop will break? There is no fixed formula for that. So this process inherently has a degree of uncertainty and a degree of randomness. So exact solution of this is not possible. The thing that we start to make look possible is that we say, well, let's say, what is the other extreme where things could happen? And say, I have a plate, and it is such that at all the time, a uniform layer of the vapor of the liquid is formed on this plate. So what we see is that this is surrounded by the vapor, and we'll see that a continuous layer of liquid is formed. So this is a layer of liquid on top of this plate, and this is where it at the bottom of the plate it becomes this white, and finally this thing falls off. So what we are seeing, we are saying that there is very nice homogeneous condensation taking place. What type of a surface will do it, we'll come to that in a minute. But that what it does is produces a nicely well behaved film on this, and this is what gets the name film wise condensation. And if you look at end view, and this is the one that we will use for learning some of the basics and developing some of the theory to understand this, is that we have this film forming up over there. The vapor which was here gradually keeps getting condensed here, a little bit condenses there, little bit condenses there, little bit condenses there. So it is adding everywhere a little bit, and at every point this film is moving down until it comes here, and finally it all drops off as a stream. There are very few practical cases where this is going to happen. And to make this happen, what it means is that you have to have very nice clean surface which is homogeneous. It has to be very clean, very smooth, very flat. Only then in some ideal cases we will begin to see this happening. And because we have formed the film, it becomes now quite easy to say, well, I can write the conservation equations for this film like we did for the equations for the boundary layer and begin to understand what is going to be happening in this case. So this is at least some basic equations can be written and some mathematics can be developed. We will go through that and we'll not worry too much again about what happens in the equations and how to solve them and what the nitty-gritty algebra, but we'll say, okay, what is the big idea that we learn from this? And what we'll be learning is, what is the trend, what is the shape of this, what happens to the heat transfer coefficient locally as you go down, and what is the total heat transfer coefficient that I get from the plate, which I can then correlate with the mass condensation rate that happens. This is what we want to know. Now that you look at these two and look at it, say, purely in a commonsensical way and say, no, which one is better? As an engineer, what is my objective? Well, for a given temperature difference, I want to have the minimum area for that condensation to take place. The question is this better or is this better? And when you look at that, we do the same thing that we looked at in forced convection or free convection when we talked about what the boundary layer does. So what do we have in this case? We have a surface which is at the lowest possible temperature in the situation, and around that we have a vapor which is at saturation temperature. This is the temperature difference in this problem. Ideally, what we would like to have is that the vapor that is here would directly come in contact with the surface, so that the maximum delta T is utilized. That will happen when the surface does not have anything on it. So if drop-wise condensation was taking place on the surface where there are no drops, that is where the vapor is in directly contact with the surface, and that is where you will see the next set of drops growing. So that is nice. And then if the drop falls down, it cleans up some of the surface behind it and exposes more fresh, clean surface directly to the vapor. What happens in this case is that all the time, this surface is blanketed by this much liquid, or in this case, we can say all this liquid, it is always sitting on this surface. That means the vapor can only get up to the boundary of this film and can never get in touch with this. That means that this film which got formed is acting like a resistance to the flow of energy from here to here and the flow of mass from here to here. What it tells us is that the heat transfer rates here will not be as good as in this case, and that's practically what we see, is that film-wise heat condensation rates are maybe 7 to 10 times less than drop-wise condensation less. So as an engineer, you actually would not like to have this type of a situation with you, but there might be certain cases where this becomes unavoidable, so you got to learn to live with it. But then the innovative part of condensation is that, can I make this surface in such a way that this does not? And there are many things that can make that happen. For example, if you take a surface which is like coated with a polymer, like your non-stick various vessels that you get, and if you try to condense on it, you will never get a film there. Very quickly drops will form and they will keep falling off from them. So that means you have encouraged drop-wise condensation on that. That is one of the ways to treat the surface and make things better for you. The flip side is that when you coat this thing with some material like that or some other, any other material which is hygroscopic, anhygroscopic, you are adding a little material there which will add its own conduction resistance to this plate, and that is a trade-off you have to do. How much can I sacrifice for conduction by putting a coating versus what advantage do I get by converting this into this? And that is what engineers do, is say, okay, I will live with this particular thing and that is the best surface I have. So what we will do now is look at what happens in this film and start looking at, so we start by looking at film-wise condensation on a flat plate, and we say that this was the plate that was maintained at a uniform temperature TW, a wall temperature, and this side the fluid is at T infinity, which in our case we will call it T sat, and that, remember, depends on the pressure. So this is a major player in condensation, like we saw in boiling, and in a minute we will see what it does. And we develop our coordinate system there. Okay, there's a question there. Is there an effect of color of surface in case of drop wise case? If yes, which color will have more effect on drop? Yeah, there's a question of what happens if there's a different color. I'll come back to it in a minute because by and large color does not matter that much. Okay, so here there is x-axis that we are putting here. This is our y direction coming up. And we see, well, how does this vapor begin to build up over here? And we argued that this is the edge of the surface of the film and it keeps growing down, which means that it is not a stationary thing. All the time vapor is condensing on it and all the time this is falling down. This is what is actually happening, and at the bottom everything then just falls down. That's what we are looking at. So let's take one point on this. We will take, say, here a location x and ask, like what we did earlier, what are the velocity and temperature profiles normal to the surface? Okay, so we'll do two things now. The first thing we will do is plot the velocity profile. So this is our point, and what we have here is that we know that there is a no slip boundary condition, so velocity at the wall has to be zero. And then you have this point where you'll have some velocity, maybe the maximum velocity at this point. So from here to here, this velocity will keep increasing. So you have a velocity profile that builds up like that. And then at the edge, there has to be a no slip condition between the liquid and the vapor. That means at this point, the vapor in contact with the liquid will have the same velocity as the liquid has at that point, which was this one. So the vapor will also have this one. And because that little vapor element here has got the same velocity, because of viscous forces, it will induce a slight velocity in layers adjacent to it. And so from here, we will see a gradual decrease of velocity going further outwards. So this is what you get, that u is a function of y. If it were a forced convection case, that means there was a downward velocity along with that, then instead of going like that, it will go finally from here. Same velocity will be there. It will may get a peak, depends on what it is, or maybe like this, and then finally settle down to whatever is the velocity of the vapor in the free state. So it could be this or it could be that. Now let's look at the temperature. At the wall, we have the lowest temperature, which is the wall temperature TW. Far away, the temperature, if it was saturated vapor, this is CT sat. So what we will see is that inside this film, there will be a gradient of temperature, and at the edge, this gradient disappears and you have a flat velocity profile, a temperature profile. So this is the way this temperature grows up, and here we have a profile where the temperature increases. If it were slightly superheated vapor, this temperature profile will continue to rise and finally come to a value slightly greater than the saturation temperature. So this is what is happening here, and so that is our T as a function of Y, how temperature varies normal to the plate. Now we have seen how the downward velocity varies normal to the plate. And now we use this information to say, I want to get a relation between H and maybe TW minus T sat minus TW. Ultimately, that's what we want. Q dot double prime, this is equal to this, or you want to get a local heat transfer coefficient, this is what we want to do. So this is determined by the dynamics of this flow, the temperature distribution in this and the velocity distribution in this. So approaches are, we can, at least for this case where you have a nice continuous film, the approach will be similar to what we have looked at for the other convection phenomena. We can write the differential equations for the film. So what we are writing it, that this is right, is being written for the liquid phase. Ideally, yes, you would also have to write the similar equation for the vapor phase with the boundary condition that there is no slip condition, same temperature condition at the film surface. So it's the same conservation of mass that we have looked at earlier, and same conservation of momentum, or rather this is x momentum. So this was what we wrote even for natural convection. The difference is that the pressure gradient here and the body force there, both are acting on the liquid. Outside there is a vapor. The density difference is very large. The vapor really doesn't cause any buoyancy, that type of a thing. So we can prove that this can be zero, and the equation just reduces to this, this, and this. And then we have the first law of thermodynamics applied here, conservation of energy. U dt dx plus v dt dy is equal to alpha del square d by del y square. And then you ask, you know, what are the boundary conditions that are applicable to these equations? And we say that at the wall, q dot double prime at the wall, this is equal to in the fluid minus kf into the temperature gradient normal to the surface, dt dy evaluated at the wall, or we can write y equal to 0, or you can write at the wall itself. And we have said, well, can I get an order of magnitude about these things? And say, okay, kf is where kf is. This thing, I need a temperature difference and a distance over which that temperature difference is being experienced. The temperature difference we have in the problem, T sat minus T wall, and as we saw in that film thickness thing, this temperature difference was acting over the thickness of the film at that point, and that is what we call as delta. So in this problem, this distance here to here, this is delta, which in turn is a function of x. That means as you keep going down, we can see that here the delta was this much, here the delta, the film thickness is this much, here the film thickness is this much, and when the fluid leaves the plate, the delta is this much. So this will be finally delta at n. This is at the height of the plate or the length of the plate, this is equal to n. So this is what we have, and we also know that we want to equate it to the heat transfer coefficient. That means q dot double prime at the wall, this is equal to hx into T sat minus Tw. So it also tells us very simply that if I combine these two, then you have hx is equal to kf, conductivity of the fluid, divided by delta at that point. Let's say that delta also x. So this is something we will use later on. As before, we have the no slip boundary condition at the wall, u is equal to 0, v is equal to 0, and then we say at y equal to delta at any location, the temperature is say equal to the temperature outside, which is the saturation temperature. So subject to these boundary conditions, we could then solve the equations. Not a very easy thing to do, but it's done only for a very simple case, and that's what we will see in a minute. And before we do that, we need some more terms in it, and so we look at the conservation equations in the integral form. So that is the plate at Tw, that's the film, and we say I'll make a control volume, which is a big one, that completely takes care of the thickness of this film. So that's our control volume, and down here it is at some point x, and the thickness of this element is delta x. And we'll write down the conservation of mass and energy equations for this, and some interesting terms will come out which will help us in the answers to the questions that we have posed. So first is conservation of mass. And what is it happening? From the upper surface, there is mass flow rate going in. From the lower one, there is mass flow rate coming out. And going into this is the condensation rate in this element, d m dot c. So this is the amount of liquid or vapor that got condensed and added mass to this control volume. So all three have to be equal. We can write that, solve it and simplify it, and you get the equation d m dot c this is equal to the gradient of integral 0 to delta rho f u dy, and that's what we have. Rho f, I am using subscripts as f and g to be consistent with thermodynamics, where f is the liquid and g is the vapor. Now we will apply conservation of energy, and we say that what are the energy inflows into this? At this side you have convection going happening, this mass is carrying its energy with it. At the lower surface you have exiting flow rate, x plus delta x is E dot, x plus delta x, the energy going out of this phase. The vapor is bringing some energy with it, E dot vapor. And at this side, the surface is having conduction, which is taking away the heat. This is Q dot W. In steady state, there will be no storage of energy in this, and it is film is also not growing. So finally, the conservation of energy becomes that E dot x plus delta x minus E dot x plus Q dot at the wall, plus energy brought in by the vapor, all of this has to be equal to 0. So those are the two equations we have, but this is the one which is more interesting, and we will take it up further to see what it gives us. So in the end, when we want an answer, like every case, we want h as a function of something, or a non-dimensional thing which we had called the Nusselt number as a function of something. In forced convection, this was a function of Reynolds number. In natural convection, we got a Grashof number there. In both cases, there was a Prandtl number floating there. So various mathematical formula came in and connected this, which we use for solving problems. In this case, we have a little tricky issue. Like natural convection, we don't have a characteristic velocity in this flow. It is the thermal aspect itself which is driving this thing. So we say, well, what will be u at this point, or what is the u variation of u at that point, or what is the mean velocity at that point? I could take that as an indicative velocity in this problem. So that's what we will do now. Say, what is the characteristic velocity? And we say at x, m dot x, this is equal to 0 to delta rho f u as a function of y into d1. So that's the mass flow rate that we had written just now, m dot x, because this mass flow rate, that is all the mass flow rate happening in this element going down. Okay, so this can be written as some representative mean velocity, we call it u bar, multiplied by the density into the area over which it takes place. So the area that it is happening is this distance, which is delta at x, multiplied by a length normal to this sheet. So that's what we have written here. This will be delta multiplied by w, which is normal to the paper, but we'll assume that this is equal to 1 unit depth condition. So this will then become u bar rho f into delta. So we have some expression for mass flow rate in terms of something u bar and delta, both of which we really don't know exactly what, how they are going to work out. But let's proceed further and say, well, what happens? Can I define at least now a non-dimensional Reynolds number? Like in natural convection, the Grashof number played the role of the Reynolds number. So let's try to create one here. This we will define as u bar into hydraulic diameter of the film at that point. So this is at any x again, divided by the kinematic viscosity of the liquid. So dh is hydraulic diameter of this, unit depth, again this, and unit depth. So sort of a rectangle that we are seeing over here, that is where the film is going through. So hydraulic diameter of this rectangular slice. So this can be written 4 times m dot at that x location, divided by the wetted perimeter, multiplied by the dynamic viscosity of the liquid, and this can be then further simplified to say 4 rho f u bar delta upon mu f. So we started getting something. We said, well, now we are able to define a mean velocity in the flow, and using that we have been able to define a Reynolds number in the flow. And what we have assumed here is that perimeter, the depth cancels out in this case, and so you have Reynolds number in terms of the mean velocity and the film thickness. This of course technically will be Re delta x, because this depends on which x location we are starting from the top of the plate. Now what happens is, having defined Re delta this way, three regimes appear in this case. That if Re delta is less than 300, we get a laminar film. If Re delta is between 300 and 1800, we get a laminar film, which is also a wavy film. And in case this is greater than 1800, then you get a turbulent film. This is entirely from experimental evidence. Okay, so we have to accept that. What it means is that on this plate, initially you will form a nice smooth surface of this layer forming up. As we keep coming down, the Reynolds number is increasing. Okay, so Re delta, we will see in a minute how it changes, and then it will become periodic but wavy, maybe this way, and maybe lateral non-uniformity may also come, and finally it becomes turbulent with mixing happening there and the surface becoming very jagged. So this is where Re delta would be 300, this is where it would be 1800. So those are the important numbers that you get for a laminar film. As I mentioned, making a laminar film isn't always the nice easiest thing to achieve, and even if you achieve it, as an engineer you would not like to achieve anyway. Now we go back and look at this equation and substitute for u bar, and we get Re delta is equal to 4 g rho f into rho f minus rho g delta cube upon 3 mu f square. What we did was, we have done something to get u bar in terms of various parameters. I have not done the detailed derivation over here. It is there in the book, so I will pass it out in the notes also. And from there we got some u bar, and that is what we have put here. So Re delta, the Reynolds number, goes as cube of the film thickness. That's what it means. So now we'll skip the detailed algebra and say, well, if I solve the conservation equations or the integral equation, doesn't matter, for the laminar film only, no dropwise condensation here, then what is the solution I get? And that is what I'm writing here, that we get a solution for the film thickness delta at any location x with this very complicated looking equation. Upon g rho f, rho f minus rho g into h f t. And this whole thing to the power 1/4 along with in terms of x. This is telling us how the boundary layer grows. Before we look at it again, let's look at h f g again. This was the energy taken away by the wall, but actually this is this plus a little bit of sensible energy that is taken from the liquid, because as we saw at the beginning, the film liquid there is going to be slightly subcooled all through the film. So we make a modified form of HFG, which is HFG prime, and this is defined as HFG plus some part of the sensible heat term, which is 0.68 Cp of the fluid Tsat minus Tw. or this is written as HFG into 1 plus 0.68 times JO. JO is a new non-dimensional number that is coming into the discussion. This is called the Jacob number. Sorry, JA. JA, this is T sac minus T wall divided by its end. Okay, so sorry, there will be a CP also here. CP. So this is what we have, that this is an important player in the problem. That's what we recognize. How cold do we make the wall? So Jacob number tells us something about that. And we make that correction to HFG because subcooling took place, and that is what we have put here. So finally, this expression will have HFG prime and not just HFG. Now when you look at this, it is telling us that delta x varies as x to the power 1 by 4. And qualitatively, this is telling us that as x increases, delta x increases, but rather weakly, and that's exactly what we have drawn to begin with in the first place. And knowing this variation, we also now get how Reynolds number will change. And in a minute, we will write down for the heat transfer coefficient and we'll see what happens to that. Okay, so this is one thing we have learned, and I have skipped the complete algebra of how to solve the conservation equations, and that what answer comes, and this is what we are learning from it. Okay, so that is one thing that we have got now. And now we say, how can I get the heat transfer coefficient? And for that, we had already written in the beginning Hx was kf upon delta. We just got delta as a function of x, and if we just substitute it into this and make a little bit of simplification, this will still give us a rather involved looking type of an expression. K cube upon h prime fg divided by 4 mu f t sat minus tw into x, all of this raised to the power 1 by 4. The only interesting thing in this is that here is the temperature difference and this is the distance. Rest all g, rho f, rho g, k, hfg prime, mu f, these are all properties of the fluid. So this is what is happening, and what it tells us now is that hx goes as x to the power minus 1 by 4. So that is what is happening. The heat transfer coefficient keeps decreasing as you go down, and that's what the physical way to explain that was, that the film was getting thicker and thicker. It became more and more of a barrier between the vapor and the wall, and this is what we were seeing there. And then we now said, I want to express this as a non-dimensional thing, so I can use in a variety of problems. And for that, you get nux. This can be defined as before, local heat transfer coefficient into distance upon kf. And the average Nusselt number for the whole plate, nu 0 to L or nu L bar, either of these. This is h bar L multiplied by L upon kf. And so if we substitute this hx value in this and solve it, we get 0.943 rho f g rho f minus rho g into hfg prime into L cube divided by mu f kf t sat minus tw. All of it is raised to the 1/4 power. So what we were looking for, we have got here. And it tells us that the left side is non-dimensional, which also tells us that this whole thing has to be non-dimensional. But it's still a fairly messy looking thing, and we will do a little more jugglery on this part to try to make it into a non-dimensional number. And let's see what will happen if we can get a relation of a non-dimensional number as a function of another non-dimensional number, that will be the nice thing to have. So we have this as the working relation. We can use this for solving problems. No problem with that. And that tells you what is the average heat transfer, average Nusselt number. From there, you can then get the average heat transfer coefficient, and then Q dot at the wall. This will be H L bar into area of the plate, which is L times the width normal to the paper, multiplied by T sat minus T W, which was the enforced temperature difference. And that is the answer we are looking for. So we'll work out a little more and see if we can make this into a non-dimensional form. So before that, the other thing that we wanted to know, m dot the condensation, what is the condensation rate over the entire plate? This we now know, we just calculated Q dot, that was Q dot for the wall. You can say that this was W divided by HFG prime, and this is H bar average heat transfer coefficient multiplied by area multiplied by the temperature difference divided by HFG prime. So that other important thing as an engineer you want to know, what is the rate of condensation on this surface? And this is the answer to that. Okay, so this is what you have seen again, Hx going as 1 upon x to the power 1 by 4, and all of this is happening because the film is acting like a barrier, and if this film were to regularly break up or form not form at all, as we saw in the case of drops, that is nice for us, and that is why Hx in those cases can be as high as 10 times more than what we are seeing in the film. Now we do what I was just saying, that try to make a completely non-dimensional relationship. So what we do is we take this Re delta definition that we had. This was HL bar L into T sat minus T wall upon rho F mu F HFG prime multiplied by 4. This is coming right from the earlier definition we had in terms of mass flow rate and the perimeter. So all we have done is added all the remaining terms. And if we simplify this, this comes out to be 3.163. Kfq g upon mu f square into 1 upon hl bar cube. So we are just substituting different things. We eliminated the temperature difference by writing it in terms of hl. That's how this 3.163 has come. And now we say, well, can I make this non-dimensional? And we say, well, look, what are the units of this thing here? So g is meters per second square, and in the denominator you have mu f square, which is meter per second square whole square, which is meter square per second. So this is meters to the power 4 second square, and this is equal to 1 upon meter cube. So the cube root of this has a length unit. So that's what we do now. We rearrange these terms over here and we say HL bar on one side, mu f square upon g divided by kf. We have taken all of that on one side. So this and this, we have rearranged it here. And this is then equal to 3.163 into Re delta to the power minus 1 by 3. So now the right side, we got like we had in convection heat transfer in force or free convection without phase change. On the right side, we had only Reynolds number dependence. Left side is still a messy looking thing, but as we just saw, H is watts per meter square per Kelvin. This whole thing is, we saw, okay, so this is to the power 1/3. This is L divided by K, which is watts per meter Kelvin. This is meter square. So everything goes off, and this whole thing is a non-dimensional number. that nice thing that came out, and we say that this entire thing is defined as a new number, a condensation number, and because we are dealing with the average heat transfer coefficient, we'll call it C0 for L and the average. If you are looking, it's only a local number, it will be CO with the subscript X. So here is a new thing that came out. We are defining this term as the condensation number, and what we have done is KF is a fluid property, kinematic viscosity is a fluid property, G is a constant. So we normalized it on certain things that we already have and came up with a non-dimensional number, which nicely relates it to the Reynolds number. And that's what we were looking for. So instead of normalizing this and calling it a Nusselt number, which gave us a very involved looking thing, we cannot develop new numbers from that, but rearranging it, we normalized the heat transfer coefficient on these parameters, came up with a new condensation definition of condensation number. So it is nothing but a non-dimensional heat transfer coefficient for condensation. That's what this number represents. And using that, we can now start getting all types of equations that we can use. That for RE delta less than 30, the average condensation number for the entire plate, this can be expressed as 1.468 into RE delta to the power minus 1 by 3. And similarly, for the other regimes also, you can get relations. These I will, some of these are simple, so I will just write it out here. 1.868 into RE delta to the power minus 1 by 3. But for RE delta more than 1800, it's a very complicated looking thing, which I will give out in the correlation sheet. We will not spend time just writing it. But it's a function of RE delta in the numerator. In the numerator, it's a function of Prandtl number and RE delta. So that it looks something like what we have been looking at in single phase heat transfer so far. And in all these cases, we say what are the temperature at which I should evaluate the properties of the liquid. So T prop is to be evaluated at the mean of the saturation temperature and the wall temperature, T sat plus TW. So this is the properties of the liquid. In all these cases, we were only getting the subscript F. So that was the liquid. So we've got the type of relations we were looking for, and moreover, what we have actually got from this whole exercise is not so much as to that, yes, we can now, if you know that there is a laminar film being formed, laminar or wavy or turbulent, we know what are the formulae to use to predict heat transfer coefficient, the heat transfer rate, and the condensation rate. So that's what we got from here. But the interesting thing that has come out is all of that, is that we are able to get Nusselt number definition in terms of various things, and we got a non-dimensional number, which is a function of some sort of a Reynolds number in the problem, which is a general form and can be extended to many other devices, or we can make corrections to this formula to come down to the values for drop-wise condensation. So that is the type of thing that has really come out of this. So we will leave this film-wise condensation definition here on the flat plate and start looking at various other geometries which are more commonly in use. Okay, the next simplest geometry that we have is a horizontal cylinder, condensation taking place on the exterior. So this is the, say, the outer surface of the cylinder. And this is surrounded by saturated vapor. And this is what is now very common. If you ever look at the power plant condenser or large condensers or air conditioning units, this is what we are looking at. So what is happening here is different types of things can happen depending on the temperature difference and the nature of the surface. the counter part of the film formation would happen here, that you could have a continuous film formed all over the surface of this, which comes down and drops down from. And if this was homogeneously happening over the length of the tube, say about up to this, say here, then here also you would get the same thing, and this will then come down. So what you are seeing happening here is this type of a film, that is a film that formed on the surface, blanketing it completely by gravity. This is what was bringing it down. It comes down, and this film then keeps dropping down. This type of condensation is called sheet condensation. It's a very idealized case. The surface has to be very clean, very smooth, and is willing such that the liquid can adhere to it and will form this thing. So again, one can then go back deep into the arithmetic of this, write all the equations, solve them, and yes, you can get all the numbers from this. From that comes a correlation that we will give in the sheet. So that we leave that part. The next thing that happens is that it doesn't form a continuous film like this, but say at some point it forms a sheet, a smaller one, and then breaks off and keeps dropping down. At some other point, you have got another bit of sheet being formed here, and this is dropping down. And so like this, from the surface, you have streaks of water condensing and falling down. They may be uniformly done, maybe somewhat randomly done, but they are joining up in some way, and they start dripping like this. And it would be something like if you see rainwater dripping from a vertical, say a surface like part of the roof or say a window which is open, you'll find that even if the rainwater is coming uniformly on the plate, it joins up and at different points it keeps dropping. Sometimes it drops from here, sometimes it drops from here, sometimes it drops from here, and that's what you get. So this is called jet condensation on the plate. And the last third method by which condensation can take place is that it forms drops. They get big, and these drops just then break off and fall down. So this is drop-wise condensation on the exterior of the cylinder. There are various correlations for this, and you can clearly see that as an engineer you would like to be in this regime, because a lot of the surface is exposed directly to the vapor. You will get very high condensation rates, and that's the nice thing about this. And expressions will be of the format mean Nusselt number based on the diameter is a function of all those complicated things, with d cube coming in there and the denominator t sat minus tw, along with a bunch of constants, all of which are typically raised to a 1/4 power. So this is something that is happening. So it tells us that as you keep increasing the diameter of the tube, you don't get that much advantage in increasing the Nusselt number. So idea would be that if you make it very small, then you can pack in also more lot of small things, and you would get maybe an advantage in the design of the machine. So that was the horizontal cylinder. Okay, now we look at what happens on a sphere. And same thing would happen as we saw for a cylinder, except that there is no length in this problem. That's a sphere, and it is inside a vapor. We are saying that it's a solid surface on which it is condensing. So either we could have a complete uniform sort of film formed everywhere, and it would drop off as a jet, or it could then form drops here and there, and then they would come off in streaks or as drops. Both are possible there. A counterpart of this, which is much more is used, is that these could be very small drops of a material on which you are trying to condense and deposit something. That is something done in very manufacturing processes also. Or we could say that I want to say that there is a drop that is going into saturated vapor. What is the rate at which condensation will take place on the drop? So this drop, say the vapor was water, and this is also water. That this is not going to happen in this type of a case. What will happen is that as condensation takes place, its temperature will increase, but the drop diameter will keep increasing with time. So it is a sort of condensation, but different in the sense that it is not this, and usually one treats this problem as a problem in mass transfer. There is no separate water or the condensate which drops off from this particular thing. There are many applications where this happens. Okay, so we have seen some basic features of film wise condensation and drop wise condensation, and from that quick analysis we got a big picture as to what can be correlated with what to get the answer. That general process will now apply to everything else, and we will now look at another very important application, which is condensation inside a tube. And this is, as I mentioned, the application of this is very simple. This is what happens in the condenser of your, say, the room air conditioner or split air conditioner. So what you have actually here is a tube, and I'm making the simplest possible case of a tube, which is just a cylindrical tube. And in this, we are putting in the vapor from this end, and we say this is saturated vapor, and we are cooling the wall. In the case of AC air conditioner, the outside unit, we blow air on it. So the inside vapor is hotter than that air, and it is slightly superheated as well. So initially, first it will get de-superheated. That is treated as a forced convection problem. We have already seen how to deal with it. At some point, it will become a saturated vapor, and now we start looking at what's going to happen. And after a while, it will become a subcooled liquid, slightly subcooled liquid. The important thing that happens here is that as it goes on, this a film will start forming on the surface, and but because of gravity, this film will not be stable, uniform. It will be thinner at the top, and you have liquid which will accumulate at the bottom. This will keep going on, and all those other regions that we had seen last time, they will, in boiling, the opposite of that will be also start happening, but the liquid will start accumulating at the bottom because of gravity, unless the flow is so fast that this thing is not allowed to happen. But this could happen at, maybe at a fairly later stages. What could happen is the opposite of what we saw as tube boiling last time, is that here's the tube in which we start putting in vapor. When the first condensation takes place, and if it does not stick to the wall, it will form a fine mist over there, that droplets in there. But as we are seeing, condensation is taking place at the wall, so these will be growing here and not growing here. Then these will become bigger and bigger drops, and as you are seeing, some of these could be attached to the wall. Then they become very big and occupy a large space in the tube, and they become like slugs. And finally, you have a lot of liquid with maybe a few bubbles of vapor floating in them, and finally it condenses completely. So this requires that the liquid not get caught on the wall surface. That's an important thing here. But that's not going to happen in all the cases. Most of the times, a mixture of that and this happens. Okay, there are questions. I'll come to that in a minute. I have a few more minutes before we wrap up the condensation discussion. Then we'll take all the questions. So, in this case also, all the answers will be in the form of a mean Nusselt number, expressed as a function of various things, in which we will have the same type of a dependence on diameter and the temperature differential that is applied. So there will be various terms over sitting there. In general, if this is what is happening, the tube length does not drastically affect the average Nusselt number, even though the liquid is dropping here, because a small part of the tube is accumulating the liquid, most of it is then covered up with this. Unless this will change, when this whole liquid is now, if the liquid occupies most of the tube, which will happen towards the end of the condensation process, yes, then everything changes altogether. Okay, so this is what is happening inside the tube. But having said that, that this sort of a thing happens, here is where people have begun to think that, look, I would like more and more of the surface to be exposed directly to the vapor. If I have a circular tube, this is what could happen. So what can I do to prevent that from happening? And people have looked at exploiting the fact that surface tension plays a role in these problems. And the simplest example of what could be done is to say that instead of a circular tube, we make a triangular tube with a sharp edges. Basically, we are saying we create sharp edges. And what this is going to do is the liquid that will condense along these will end up accumulating preferentially at the corners. So the corners will see the liquid there and leave more of the surface here exposed to the vapor which is there. So this will keep growing as it goes out, but here you have lots of surface directly exposed to the vapor. So that means that the average heat transfer coefficient in this case is more than this type of an application. And that's what people have been trying to do a lot, either this. And there are examples that you can see in the world, in the market, as you can see some air condensers. The tubes are made by making them into walls which are, say, square. And it now depends on the convenience of manufacturing. This may not be very easy to manufacture. This may be easy to manufacture. And when you do that, liquid will get captured in the corners and you will get much better heat transfer coefficient from these. So these are already in the market. I'll show you some pictures also after this. But this is the idea where a lot of the research has happened, that instead of leaving a smooth surface, can I give it some type of a roughness or put, say, grooves on it and enhance the heat transfer coefficient. A lot of this has happened, and almost all the condensers that you see today, they have some sort of one of these things actually in there. And all of that will we see that all of this theory was fine. Film wise condensation gave us some idea. Now let's complete the picture and say, well, what happens in drop wise condensation? And the fact was, as I mentioned, that H bar, when you have drop wise condensation, because more surface of the surface is exposed to the vapor compared to film wise condensation, we could see up to a 10 times increase in heat transfer rates. So that's why, whether so you try to do application in such a way that you always try to break away the film that is forming on the surface, whether it was natural convection, forced convection, or boiling, or this, that everywhere you try to reduce the gap between the fluid which you want heat transfer and the surface which is the other part. Same idea is coming here. So I've just shown how the shape of the tube and maybe even the external cases on the surfaces, what one does is that if you have to have a tube on which condensation is taking place on the outside and you want to promote drop wise condensation on this tube, which is coat it with a material which is anhygroscopic, which prevents the formation of bubbles. So you do a selective coating. A simplest thing you can see in the kitchen itself, you put a little bit of oil on something and then you put a drop of water on it, it doesn't stick. Something you can see, even if you put oil on your hands and then you put water in it, you will find that immediately the water breaks up and forms lots of small, small drops. That is what was encouraging drop-wise behavior. Coatings, as I mentioned, they add a conduction resistance. So you have a trade-off taking place, that the coating increases the conduction resistance, but it decreases the convective resistance. So at some point you say, okay, which is the best combination, and we'll stick with that. So that is what is done. The other danger with putting coatings is that as you keep using it time and time again, these coatings will then come off or wear off. So you have a life issue related to the life of the tube. That is something you have to worry about. Once the coating is gone, then you have lost all the advantage that of drop-wise condensation. It will increasingly start behaving like, maybe partially at least, like film-based condensation. So that is the trade-off one does with coatings. Okay, so now I will take some questions and then I will wrap up the remaining part of the material that I have. Okay, let's start with this. First question, is there any effect of color of the surface? Any effect of color? All the discussion we have seen that the thing that matters as far as condensation goes is the hygroscopic nature of the material. The color is not so much an issue at all. But I don't know where the application you are looking at from. The color would be an issue if, say, we have a plate which is exposed to solar radiation, it is absorbing and some phase change is taking place over there, then yes, the color becomes an important part if radiation is an issue. But please be also a little wary that every surface that looks black is not a black surface, and in fact many other colors, like say whitewashing of a wall or distempering of a wall, even though you may think I made a white surface, practically it is actually for infrared radiation, it very much behaves like a black surface. Okay, so that is the issue of color. Next question, it says, what is the basic difference between film wise condensation and drop wise condensation? Okay, so let me again revise what happens. Now that we have gone through the whole discussion, here is what it does. That in film wise condensation, you have a surface, I'm taking a plate or maybe a drop, and homogeneous condensation takes place everywhere on this surface, and you have a film of liquid always present on the top of this thing, and finally it falls off. So the surface always has a continuous film of liquid all over it, and that does not depend with this distance, and so it is blanketing the surface at all times. In drop wise condensation, we do not get a continuous film being formed, but the surface which is exposed will see growth of drops at some point. At random places, the drops will keep growing, keep getting bigger. It starts as a small drop, gets a bigger drop, and finally, because of gravity, these drops will begin to fall down. What the drop does is, say this is a big drop that formed here and it wants to fall down, and in front of this there are lots of small drops which are still getting bigger and bigger, but as this drop falls down, it picks up all these drops and becomes a bigger and bigger drop and falls down, and behind it, whatever surface it traverses, it flushed out all the liquid which was sticking to that material. What that means is that that surface was now directly in contact with the vapor outside. So that is the nice thing that happened, that this drop keeps going down, this drop keeps going down, and so a large fraction of the surface here, surface area, is directly in contact with vapor, which is nice because this will bring the highest temperature difference in the smallest possible distance. This is not happening in film wise condensation, where the film acts like a resistance to heat transfer between the vapor outside and the surface on the inside. So here, as I just mentioned, H is much smaller, here H is much greater. That's the difference. So in terms of physics, this is what is happening. This is a much more mathematically well behaved problem. This is a stochastic problem which is quite random in nature. Okay, the question is, which type of condensation is better and why? Well, it depends which, what you mean by type. We could say that I want to condense, say, the vapor in a refrigeration plant, and I have options. I can put the refrigerant through a tube and condense it, or I can have lots of tubes through which I put my cooling water, and on the outside of this tube, I have vapor which is condensing. For large applications, this type of the design is preferred. This is good for windows and split ACs and smaller units, but all central air conditioning units where you want large heat transfer rates, this is the preferred thing. Okay, but now that you have mentioned it, let me add on a few things on this from what we had looked at. We looked at what happens on condensation on a single tube. But in an application like the condenser of a central AC plant, we are not going to keep one tube. So So what we will do is we'll put other tubes around it, and then put more tubes around this, and say, well, and build a whole tube bank. And so, well, now what happens? How do I predict average heat transfer for all these tubes? Well, what is we have to recognize is that when we do that, something condensed over here, this fell off, maybe as a drop or as a stream. It came on this tube, and so now it blanketed this tube, formed a thicker layer of liquid on it. Then it fell off, and it formed an even thicker layer of liquid on it, and then this kept falling down. What was happening is that as you go down, and remember we are going down because gravity is playing here, as you keep going down, the thickness of the liquid film on the tubes keeps increasing as you keep going down. That means the average heat transfer coefficient of the first row, this is very high, highest, the second row will be even less, the third one will be even less, and if I take the average of this, this average heat transfer coefficient for a large number of tubes will be less than what was there on the first tube or the second tube. So we have to learn to make a trade-off and say, look, this is what's going to happen, fine, what's the next best thing that I can do, and how many tubes should I put, and we'll design the condenser that way. So to answer your question, for smaller applications, we are okay with condensation inside tubes. For larger applications, at least for refrigeration cases, we go for condensation outside tubes. But this is something which is there, and for this, we have to have a modified form of the Nusselt number, and that I will give in the sheet, where you can say that if it was only one tube, and this was the Nusselt number, and now I have 9 tubes, one below the other, what is the average Nusselt number in that? So that we can get from there. Okay, the next question is, if same condenser is to be used for different refrigerant, then how the mass flow rate can be found for complete phase transformation at the other end? Okay, the question is that if we have a condenser, say a refrigeration condenser or an air conditioning condenser, into which we are putting in a substance, working substance is A, some refrigerant. We have got the hardware with us, and now we want to change it, and instead of A, we want to put the refrigerant B. So earlier this was using R23, now you want to use R134A. So what happens? Well, the first thing that everybody does is to redo the experiment all over again and check and figure out what is the heat transfer coefficient you get over that length, and then say whether it will be adequate or whether it will be inadequate. The average relations that we got for Nusselt number, they are only indicative and they will have a bit of uncertainty with it, but within that, if you get a clear answer, we can say yes, you can put this, or no, you cannot put this. It will not completely condense. Okay, and whether or not it completely condenses is simple, that you, what you want to happen is m dot, which is the mass flow rate that you have set, into HFG prime, which is all the energy that has to be taken out, is this equal to the average heat transfer coefficient into length into the perimeter of this multiplied by the temperature difference T sat minus TW, and are these two equal or not? That will tell you whether complete condensation has taken place or not taken place. But practicing engineers, this is what they have done. They do that experiment again and again. You have a setup, you just remove this material, put the other material and see what happens, and you get the answer for that. That's how traditionally the substitution of refrigerants in such cycles has happened. Okay, then, okay, what is the reason for sudden increase and decrease in heat transfer coefficient during phase change process? Okay, so here is what happens. We saw natural convection, forced convection last time, and we said that everywhere in those cases, we had a boundary layer which acted like a buffer between the colder fluid and the hotter surface, or hotter fluid and the cold surface. Thicker that layer, more is the resistance. That's the problem. Now, what happens in two-phase flows? In the condensation that we have seen just now, if you have a plate, and if this had a continuously a film on it, then you would not expect a sudden change in the local heat transfer coefficient at any point. Say you are sitting over here and say, I will figure out what it checks as a function of time, and it will vary because in an experiment it has to vary a little bit, but it will vary within a very small limit and it won't be a drastic variation. Here is when the drastic variation will happen. You have a plate, and on this, we start seeing the buildup of a drop. What does that depend on? Like what we saw last time on nucleation site. And that I mentioned about the texture of the surface, the nature of the material, and whether this was natural roughness, that is you just rolled the plate and got it, or we manufactured the roughness. These days there is a lot of research going on this part, that you create small little imperfections in the surface, either putting it up or putting it down, and that site where nucleation will happen. So coming back to your question, this drop will start building up. It became small. That means the area over which this drop is in contact with it, that area, the local heat transfer coefficient has gone down. But here, adjacent to the drop, the local heat transfer coefficient is still high, because the vapor is here, it is directly in contact with this, but here, the vapor coming here is in contact with the drop, and then the liquid, and then the surface comes. Now, if this drop continues to grow like that, in that contact area, the local heat transfer coefficient will become much smaller, because now you got much more resistance sitting there in the form of a warmer liquid. But now, as soon as this drop breaks off and falls, this very surface is again exposed to the vapor there. So at one instant, this surface was seeing the drop. At the next instant, this drop was not there. So at some, when the drop was there, the heat transfer coefficient there was low. The moment it disappeared, locally the heat transfer coefficient increased dramatically. And as we have seen, the film gives us an idea that the presence of a liquid on this decreases heat transfer coefficient by up to a factor of 10. So suddenly it goes away, again locally the heat transfer coefficient goes up, and again as the drop builds up, the heat transfer coefficient drops, as the drop goes, again it increases. This is what is happening in the case of condensation. The counterpart of this question was what happens in boiling. And this was an example I was giving last time, that there are many applications, say like the chip cooling these days, and we want to cool this. So what we did is we took a liquid drop and sent it to the surface. As soon as it hit it, the surface temperature T wall was greater than the saturation temperature. Locally, boiling started taking place, and the drop, as soon as it touched, it suddenly took away a lot of heat. But then as the drop evaporated, or it broke up and moved away, it exposed the surface back to the next drop. So its temperature, if it has got a low heat transfer coefficient when the drop is sitting on it, as soon as the drop goes away, it again sees the vapor. Because the vapor is there, heat transfer coefficient is very poor. As soon as the drop again hits, heat transfer coefficient increases. As it boils, it becomes even more. And then as it goes away, it comes back into vapor. So the point at the time when the drop, when there is no drop and no boiling, heat transfer coefficient is very poor. The moment the drop comes, it increases. The moment it begins to vaporize, it increases even more. As it moves away, it again goes down. So it is usually a transient nature of this problem, a time-dependent phenomena, which causes the local heat transfer coefficient to vary that much. And if this was a constant heat flux surface, what it means is that when the drop is there, it is cool. As soon as the drop goes away, the surface becomes very hot. That is what is happening. Okay, then the next question is difference between natural and forced convection. Well, we have already explained that in forced convection, it is an external agent which is driving the fluid. In natural convection, it is the delta T which is driving the fluid. And yesterday we got ourselves a relation, that importance of Grashof number or Reynolds number to the power square. The value of this parameter will tell us whether this is a forced convection problem or a natural convection problem or a mixed convection problem. So that is what it is there. Very crudely, in a commonsensical way, in forced convection, we create flow of the fluid by, say, a pump or a blower or wind or something like that. In natural convection, the fluid is stationary, and the temperature gradient that has been forced on the fluid, that temperature gradient is causing a flow to be established because of body forces. Okay, so that's the difference between forced and natural convection, and the same thing we just saw in the case of boiling also, and also for condensation. Okay, how to enhance heat transfer in double pipe heat exchanger? Okay, I'll come to that in a minute when I show pictures. The idea is that if you are doing phase change or even without phase change, one of the things to do, and this is where what we have learned comes in very handy, the general question of if I want to increase heat transfer rate, say on a flat plate, what should I do? Well, I got a boundary layer building up over there, which is acting like a barrier. Can I do something to knock out this boundary layer or disturb this boundary layer? That's the type of thing we like to do. Or if it was a flow in a tube, what we saw was that you got a temperature gradient building up, say you are heating the fluid, and a velocity gradient has formed over there. If I want to increase the gradient at the surface, what I can do is disturb the fluid at the walls and make it mix again and again. And this is one of the things that is done in some of the, even the automotive radiators, that what they do is inside this tube where the coolant is flowing, you start putting barriers of some type so that this fluid starts going more and more upward, it starts mixing, and that's how you get better heat transfer coefficient. So that is one of the way to do it. If there are concentric tubes, there also you can do the same thing. There are various ways you can make it happen. This way you can make it swirl, all type of things are possible. You can roughen the surface, that is also possible. But important thing here is that in all heat transfer equipment design, the heat transfer problem and the fluid flow problem are strongly connected. When heat transfer coefficient, when you do something like this to increase heat transfer coefficient, or you make grooves here or roughen the surface, heat transfer coefficient goes up, but so does the pressure drop. Which means that the pump or the blower which was establishing the flow now has to do more work to establish, do that. So you have a penalty on the system design by way of more power consumption for pumping or blowing, where at the same time you got the advantage of better heat transfer coefficient inside this. This is always a trade-off that is fundamental to all heat transfer equipment design. I have not talked too much about delta P, but in all the things that we have looked at, skin friction coefficient is what was coming in, and through pipes and all, we can calculate the pressure drop and the heat transfer coefficient. Okay, so give some applications of convection. Well, I'll just show you some pictures of condensation just now. Convection applications, I had shown a lot of it time and again. I'll show some more now. Okay. And then in case of film formation, why velocity decreases with increment in thickness of boundary layer? Okay, so this is a question as to why. What we are seeing here is that as the film thickness increases, what happens to the average velocity at this point? That means u, y, how is it as a function of x? So I think the formula that we had put up here, I'll just put that formula. Okay, I can't find that sheet right now. What is happening is that as x increases, the delta is increasing, and the rate at which, say, you take a small element here and ask how much dm dot c takes place here, and we take a similarly a small element here and say how much dm dot c takes place here. So this is dm dot c at location 1, and here I have dm dot c at location 2. So this is location 2. Which one will be more? If the width is the same, here the thickness of the film is less. So we can say that this one is much greater than dm dot c at 2. It means the amount of mass being added to the film has become less and less. And that is the reason why your mass flow rate will not increase, keep on increasing the way it was. The other thing that determines the velocity of this film is the fact that it is a gravity related flow, and this is being pulled down, so it's becoming bigger and bigger, and that's how you get variation in the down the velocity in u with x. What is the use of radiation shield? Okay, yeah, it's not related to convection as such, but okay. Here is what the radiation shield idea is like. And I'll give an example. So we have a big duct through which the gas is flowing, and we want to measure the temperature with some instrument. So we have put the instrument where the sensor is sitting over there. The walls of this thing are exposed to the atmosphere. So this is T infinity. So the T wall is less than Tg. The question is, what will be the temperature shown by the instrument? So we will call it the bulb of the instrument TB. And for that, you just have to see what are the heat transfer modes taking place to this. So what is happening is that there is convection over this. So TB is less than is TB to TG temperature difference. This will cause convection to the bead, Q dot convection, and this bead will radiate to all these surfaces. So in steady state, you have heat given to the bead by convection is equal to heat lost by the bead to the walls. So we get an equation where H into A, area of the bead, into T gas minus TB, this is the heat transfer rate to the bead. This is equal to, say, roughly sigma A TB to the power 4 minus T wall to the power 4. So instrument will show a temperature less than the gas temperature. This is the problem. So what one can do is we will enclose this in a small foil. So I do not impede the flow of gas in this. But now, this bead does not see the wall, but it sees the foil. And foil is also getting gas over it, and its temperature will be not as low as the bead, because this is going to be radiating to the wall also. So its temperature will be slightly more than what the wall temperature is. But the important thing is that we have drastically cut down the radiation from this to the wall. And so you get a much more representative measurement of the gas temperature than what you had without the radiation shield. This is one example. There are many other examples of this where radiation shield act like insulators. Okay, so we'll now come to the last few parts of the lecture. And we'll spend some time looking at two things, and then I'll show some. One, in condensation problems, we always have an issue, the effect of non-condensables. And why is this important? Let's take the example of a power plant condenser, and if you look at the TS diagram and everything else that we do, this is the thing. The inlet condition to the condenser is this, and we want to condense it into this. And the temperature at which we want to do is the lowest possible temperature that we have, which is the ambient water temperature or the air temperature. That is where we are dumping the heat. So typical condensation temperatures will be order of 35-40 degrees Celsius, because the water 40-45 degrees Celsius, because the water could be like 25 to 30-35 degrees Celsius. So the pressure inside this condenser will be Psat at say 45 degrees Celsius, which is of the order of like 10 to 15 kilopascal. And ambient pressure in which the whole turbine sits and the condenser sits is 100 kilopascal. So there is a huge pressure difference between the inside of the condenser and the surrounding, and it's already a very large sized equipment, and to make each and every joint completely leak proof in the real world is not possible. And somewhere along the line, because of this pressure difference, air will leak into the steam flow. Now what happens? Say this is a condenser and we have lot of tube over there. This is the steam coming in there, it has to condense, and along with this from some places air has leaked in, and air is N2 and O2. At the bottom of this we have liquid condensate that is collected and we are taking it up. What happens here is that as this vapor comes and starts condensing on this, it carries with it the nitrogen and oxygen also, and they will come and start sitting around the tubes. And they have no other place to go because they cannot go through the water here. Some of it, yes, will get dissolved in this water and go, but that's a very small amount and that's not good for the boiler anyway. That's a different problem. But you start getting accumulation of nitrogen and oxygen in this cylinder. So what happens now? We have studied that if you have a tube and outside this I was doing condensation, then here there was vapor. Condensation means that some of these, that vapor molecule here will attach to this, some more will attach to it, there is a big decrease in volume, so there will be a sort of a net flow of vapor molecules towards the surface. Add to this some nitrogen and oxygen and you will realize that these nitrogen and oxygen will just come and sit there. They have no place to go. So they will keep building up here. So now you have a problem that the H2O molecule which has to reach the surface has to go through these air, nitrogen and oxygen molecules to get there. So you got these N2 and O2 molecules sitting there as some sort of a resistance. It impedes the flow of the vapor up to the tube, which means that not enough vapor can reach the surface and you have a real problem. Measurements show that 1% by mass of air leads to a 50% decrease in the average heat transfer coefficient. That is a huge penalty, which means that you cannot condense that much steam, which means that the whole cycle, if you have to look at it, it cannot generate as much, and you have decreased heat transfer coefficient by 50%, condensation rate goes down by 50%, the capacity, generating capacity of the whole power station goes down by 50%. That's a huge loss. So what do we do? So what engineers do is that we cannot make a 100% leak proof machine anyway. So in the condenser, the tubes are arranged in a certain way so that you give path. So I'm just drawing some tubes. So you make the condenser in such a way that vapor can enter here, it can enter there, it can enter there, it can enter there, like that. And why we do it? To avoid the fact that you don't want too many tubes vertically one below the other. So you are trying to make passages where the vapor can penetrate a whole bunch of tubes and be in more intimate contact with the tube surface. So all of this comes here, and what it does is that as the liquid condenses and goes off, and ideally you would also like to make tubes in such a way that here also at the bottom also we start making such passages. So the steam coming from the turbine, which is say coming from the top, is given multiple passages to penetrate the tube bundle, and what it does is all these non-condensable nitrogen and oxygen which were there, it begins to accumulate in this area. So we increase the heat transfer coefficient one way. That was a nice thing for us. At the same time, we pushed nitrogen and oxygen to one part of the condenser tube bank. And then what we did here, we put a big tube with openings in it, holes in it, and this tube is connected to a vacuum pump. So this is operating all the time and sucking out this thing. Some vapor will also go with it. But the important thing was that these N2 and O2, which were getting, which came into the flow, they got accumulated here and they got thrown out. And so that way, we minimize the adverse impact of non-condensables. Okay, the another thing, a tube cross section I've already mentioned. So power plant condenser, this is what we do. Tube cross section, did we also, so in this application of a power plant condenser, we said that we have a tube bundle and we arrange these tubes not in a regular fashion but in a way that enhances the vapor to come into more contact with the surfaces and also take the non-condensable to one point. So that's an important thing that happens here. And remember, the number of tubes in a large power station like a 500 megawatt unit, these tubes could be of the order of number of 50,000 tubes. So these are not small number, very large number of tubes. So that's one thing. And what happens in such cases is something that is a real world thing, which is called fouling. When the tubes are new, the surface is clean. But gradually with use, it might get corroded. If it is using dirty water, like all power station condensers do, they just use river water or ocean water. Gradually things begin to develop and they deposit on this. That is called fouling. This could be deposits of very fine mud or maybe algae growing on it, something like that. And this introduces an additional conduction resistance. So now the tube surface has got an additional impediment in it. So this was the inside tube surface. We got this fouling thing sitting over here, and inside also and outside also there could be fouling on the steam side. So what this fouling did, inside where you had water flow, say in the condenser, you had water here. This water now was in contact with the fouling material and not with the tube material. This acts like a conduction resistance. On the outside also this acts like a conduction resistance. And because of that, your overall heat transfer coefficient goes down. This is a real issue, and the way we tackle it in heat transfer analysis is in the design of this equipment, we accept that there will be some fouling taking place based on experience. And so whatever heat transfer coefficient we've got on the inside or the outside, we build in a penalty in it by saying that we need that much area, but I will add 10% more or 20% more area, because I know that today the new heat exchanger will be very good. 5 years later when it is fouled, I still want it to be reasonably good, so I will add more area into it. The other option is to somehow clean it, which is you open it and clean it and then get back into action. So this is something one does. And then we have various types of tube cross sections. We could have tubes for condensation which are small, say grooves like this, which run all along the length and they are helical in shape. That is being done. There could be, the people are making surfaces where they make these types of roughnesses on it inside the tube. That is also possible. So this is where condensation will begin and the liquid will get trapped. Instead of the liquid being here, it will be here then. So that's a lot of innovations are still going on, and there is still a lot of requirement for innovating surfaces that can do this, and predictive methods of how such a stochastic process, how it can be predicted. Okay, now I will spend the last few minutes trying to show you the sheet that I put up on the forum. This is an example of a sheet where I've just compiled correlations which are there in books. Okay, the difference is that the formulae are the same. I have just tried to make it in a format which is easy to use, so that the first thing is you know what is the condition that we are using, and which correlation to use. So like this, this is a case which says forced convection flat plate isothermal. So we have shown that this is a plate, there is U infinity T infinity coming on this, we have shown the boundary layers building up, this part is laminar, this part is turbulent, and T means it is an isothermal plate. Critical Reynolds number is written here, that below this it is laminar, above this it is turbulent, and T film says what is the temperature at which you have to evaluate the fluid properties for the calculations. And inside this we have written this to equation 7.2. This is as a reference from the books from which these have been taken. Okay, so in case there is a doubt, you please refer to that book and that will give you the correct number. I have tried my best to make sure there are no mistakes in this, but just in case. Then you have two columns here. So here I have given delta H by F, which is the hydrodynamic boundary layer thickness, skin friction coefficient, average skin friction coefficient, what is the formula. Then there are three regions for Prandtl number very much less than 1, Prandtl number about 1, Prandtl number very much less than 1, Prandtl number much greater than 1. And a variety of correlations are there which have all been listed here. The first one tells you how the thermal boundary layer grows, then local Nusselt number equation, average Nusselt number equation. And then what happens if Prandtl number very much less than 1, I have written this, delta T by X, it is blank, we do not have any formula in the book for this, so I have left it blank. One would have to look up the research literature and see what this is. Prandtl number very much greater than 1, this is the local Nusselt number, we can integrate it and get the average Nusselt number. If it's the turbulent case, we have similar equations for that, but now this is a turbulent boundary layer where it is completely from this point to this point. The average heat transfer coefficient, these are given over here. Okay, so and some explanations have been given in this part. So this is a typical correlation sheet that I have already put up. And the example is of forced convection inside a tube. And this picture tells you that you are looking at smooth entry into a tube, U infinity, T infinity. Inside tube diameter is D. Two columns are there. One is the isothermal tube wall. The other is the isoheat flux tube wall. The properties are evaluated at the mean of the inlet and outlet temperatures, and it is laminar flow, so RED is less than 2300. And for that, you have the local skin friction coefficient. Then this tells you what is the length required with the hydrodynamic entry region. What is the length of that? And then we have what is the Nusselt number, what is the Nusselt number including the developing region, and for that, there are different formulae over here. And the range on which these formulas are applied, they are also listed here. That is for this Prandtl number and like that. For the isoheat flux case, if it is a fully developed flow, your Nusselt number is 4.36. If you have the developing region plus this, then the Nusselt number is this, and it's the average Nusselt number. And the third one I'll show is here for free convection on a vertical plate. I made two pictures here. This is the plate which is heated. So hot fluid is rising up, a laminar boundary layer develops, and this arrow means that there is a transition over there. The counterpart also I have shown that if the plate is cold, it will be laminar like this and then it will become turbulent and fall down. So for both of these cases, one for the isothermal wall and for the constant heat flux wall, Grashof number definition, the temperature at which we calculate the properties is given, average local and average Nusselt numbers are given there. And what if it's a laminar region and for the turbulent region. So both these are given here. So the only reason for putting this together is that in a very quick pictorial way, you are able to see what is it that the problem is and for that which correlation to use. So it just makes life a little more easier. I have compiled all these correlations in this pictorial format and I put it up on the forum. So you can please use this in solving the problems. If you want to look up the book and use it, that is also fine. But the only thing is that books just give a big listing of various correlations, and quite often you have to read a lot of that before you know which is the right one to use. This will make it easy to use. That's the only thing. Okay. The last few minutes, I'll show you a few pictures of what I have just talked about condensation. Okay, so here's the first picture of a power station condenser. And this is one particular manufacturer's design, and what they have done is instead of just putting all the tubes and packing up the whole space, and just to give an idea how big this would be, this dimension, the width of this, this could be like about maybe 3 to 4 meters, and the height could be another about easily 3-4 meters. So you're looking at a pretty big thing, maybe even 5 meters, I don't know. So what they've done is, you can see this empty space here, which has been left blank without tube, and in between the tubes have been packed over there. So this is what this particular designer has done. He says, okay, the vapor can penetrate the tube bundle here, it can come here. So more and more vapor is being brought closer and closer to as many tubes as possible to increase the average heat transfer coefficient. So that is one type of design that is there, what I was just explaining. You can see the number of tubes is very, very large. This is another picture of a tube sheet, tube bundle layout of another power plant. And here you can see they have made lot bigger passages for the steam to flow through. So these are all, what you see is actually thousands and thousands of tubes which have been put here, and they run the full length normal to this. That length typically is about 10 meters, 10 meters, 15 meters per day, very long tubes. And so you can see that they have left big gap here. So this vapor can come here, it can go there, it can go there, then it can go there, it can go there. So you have engineered it in such a way that you are increasing the penetration of vapor into the tubes, and all of this is done simply because of the reason that we have just mentioned. And in the middle, they have left a blank space over here. This is where the non-condensables will come in, and from where these are pumped out. These days, even such problems are solved by computational techniques. They are a little more complicated than single phase heat transfer, but that also means that there is a good opportunity to do a lot of innovative work yet. So here you have passages left like that, then passages horizontal, and then from the center portion, we have left it blank, so the non-condensables will go there and they can be sucked out from there. So this is a tube plate. These are big sheet metal plates which are put two together. And how do you drill 25,000 holes on a grid? Well, numerically controlled drilling machines, and you just keep on doing it. The whole operation will take maybe a week to drill the tube plate. Here is the answer to one of the questions you have there. What can you do to increase heat transfer of the tubes? And this is a typical condenser tube that I am showing here. You have cut this tube, and what you see in this is these small serrations. So if you can look at this surface here, you can see very small sharp things coming, poking out. So these are serrations, and these run over the entire length of the tube, not straight, but spirally, slightly grooved. And the idea is to enhance condensation heat transfer in this tube. Because what will it do is, as I mentioned, because of surface tension, the liquid will get caught between these small little gaps inside, and that way more of the tube surface will be exposed to the vapor. It increases the heat transfer coefficient. Air conditioning evaporator or a condenser. And what you see here is what I was drawing earlier, that this is a extruded shape with these type of shapes already in it. So all along the length it is like this. So although it looks rectangular, there are lots of these square things. And what you are seeing in this particular case is a technology patented by this company where they manufacture the fins which are integral to the surface. Unlike all the things that you see where the fin is manufactured separately, tube manufactured separately, the two are then joined. How they are joined is quite an interesting thing you can explore. But here is a thing where you have a lot of parallel passages which are not circular but deliberately square with sharp edges into which the condensate will get captured, and you get relatively high heat transfer coefficient in this. So this is all done from the type of basics that we have learnt in heat transfer just now. And I'll just say that we have tried to give you an overview of all types of things that happen in heat transfer. Important things that came out were that we have correlations between Nusselt number that we use for solving, but those are a non-dimensional way of expressing the solution of the conservation equations. We did go into the conservation equations, because if you want to do any state-of-the-art engineering for heat transfer, we are not going to use correlations as the final answer, but as a beginning answer to get an idea. But to optimize it and innovate on the technique, one has to go back to the conservation equations in differential form, discretize them, and do a numerical simulation on a computer or a supercomputer. That's how the world is going on. And with that, I hope you have now a breadth of doing simple problems at this point, and you also know what is it that you need to learn if you want to do more advanced heat transfer. So with that, we will stop. Thank you.